structure, zero by liquid. I'm not counting the atmospheric pressure here. So what will be the average pressure? Sum the two, h rho g plus zero, divide by two, and that gives you half of it. So that is the pressure on the wall of the container. If you want to find out that what is the total pressure at any point inside of it, you have to add the atmospheric pressure. But let's understand one thing. Atmospheric pressure for the wall will be from inside as well as from outside. So there is not going to be any major effect it is going to put on it. Right, next. There's a very important law associated to the pressure. Pascal law. Read the language. The pressure applied to a confined liquid at rest. Please apply this law only when the liquid is at rest. What happens when the liquid is in motion? We'll talk about that also, but at the later stage. Liquid should be in rest position, confined. Then pressure is equally transmitted. And every point is experiencing the same pressure. But here is a point. Is it? If it is same, then pressure at the top of the liquid and the bottom of the liquid should be equal. No. If I go depth wise, which is along the acceleration due to gravity, the pressure changes there. But if I keep myself on the horizontal level, I'll find the pressure everywhere is going to be same. Why is it same? Because liquid has a tendency to move from high pressure side to low pressure side. Try to adjust the pressure and then it becomes at equilibrium. So when liquid is at rest at the same level, the pressure must be same. Right? This is the condition. Yes, next please. How to measure a pressure? Maybe of a gas or maybe of a liquid. We have a U-tube shaped device which is open from both the ends. And we connect one of its end to a vessel where we have gas and for which we are trying to find out the pressure. But if in pressure is there, liquid push or liquid is pushed down from the side where pressure is more, the liquid starts rising on the other side and creates some kind of a level difference. This level difference helps us to find out that what exactly is the pressure in the gas in the vessel. And formula is quite simple. See what I told you. The pressure in a stationary liquid at the same level must be same. All right. So look at the point A and B. If everything comes to rest after some time, then pressure at A and pressure at B must be same. Let's write down the pressure. Who is the cause of the pressure at A? Nothing but the vessel. Vessel is not exposed to atmosphere. So there is no atmospheric pressure there, but the pressure is put by the gas there. That makes it to move down by a distance which is equals to H0. If I come to this side of the tube, I find that this tube is open from the top. If it is open from the top, atmospheric pressure will be there on the surface, upper surface. And because of this depth, capital H, there will be a pressure which is equals to H rho g. That's the formula. So we can easily find out that what is the pressure of the gas, right? So this is the relation how we calculate the pressure using a manometer, right? Manometer is a device which is used to measure the pressure. Now, how to measure the atmospheric pressure? But if I want to measure the atmospheric pressure, I have to take a whole column of the atmosphere, which extends to nearly 200 kilometers from the surface of Earth. Very difficult. I have a trick. You take a tube, fill it with the mercury to the top, take its length nearly 1 meter. I'll tell you why so. Fill it completely with the mercury, close it with the help of your thumb, and invert it in the mercury chamber. What will happen? Mercury has its own weight. Try to push. But again, the condition, Pascal law, at same level, pressure must be Same. Agree to it? Now look at the point A and B. B is exposed to the atmosphere. A is not exposed to atmosphere because it's a closed one. You do not allow the air to enter into it. So this mercury column stands vertically at certain height. At the top is perfect vacuum because air cannot enter into it. So there will be some height difference in the mercury column of this height, which is equals to small h. And as we know that the pressure is equals to h rho g. So pressure at point A will be equals to zero. Zero why? Because the vacuum is there. Vacuum is not exerting any pressure. But the column is there, which is of the height equals to h rho g. You might have learned that the atmospheric pressure under the normal conditions are, say at maybe on the surface of Earth, is 760 millimeter of mercury. This is the language we use. 760 millimeter amounts to 0.76 meter. I can use this formula to find out the atmospheric pressure using the relation h rho g. Here the h is the height of this mercury column, rho is the density of the mercury, and g is the acceleration due to gravity. Height we have seen, as I told you, is nearly 0.76 meter. I'm putting everything in the SI system now. Density of the mercury is 13.6 into 10 to the power 3 that we have seen in the first slide. Acceleration due to gravity near the surface of Earth may be taken close to 9.81 meter per second square. Is there a value? So this amounts to be nearly 1.013 into 10 to the power 5. Since everything is in the SI unit, so this will be Newton per meter square, or sometime we call this as Pascal, right? So this is the atmospheric pressure. Whenever there is a need, it may not be given in the question, so you have to put this value from your side sometime. So remember, the value is close to 10 to the power 5 Newton per meter square, right? This atmospheric pressure. And this comes from this concept that the mercury stands at certain height and the pressure at the same level is always equal. Yeah, this is a very interesting one. I hope all of you are aware of the pseudoforce. Have you heard of this word pseudoforce? But this is a very important concept from the question point of view. Pseudoforce concept. If I have a frame at rest, there is no pseudoforce. But if I have a frame where some acceleration is there, so the frame is going with some acceleration. Suppose you are in a car and car is accelerating. I call this type of the frame as non-inertial frame. Whenever there's an acceleration, it's a non-inertial frame. Suppose you are in a car and car is accelerating. You, as an observer in the car, always experience a force in the opposite direction. You might have seen the things lying on the dashboard, they get a push in the backward direction and you have to handle it. This acceleration of the frame puts a pseudo acceleration on a body in the opposite direction. This is because of inertia, let me tell you. This is due to the inertia. Same happens when I have this beaker under the acceleration. If I make this liquid with some acceleration. I'm doing it with a uniform velocity. I don't want this water to spill out. But if I do it with some acceleration, you may notice that the surface of the liquid is no more horizontal. It becomes a bit slanted. How to get the angle? How to use it when there is a pseudo acceleration? Number of questions comes on this particular aspect. So this is treat this as a very important point. How to do it? I have an acceleration towards my right side. So as the whole liquid is experiencing a pseudo acceleration in the opposite direction, but at the same time, I have the acceleration in the vertically downward direction too. This is a vector quantity. This G is a vector quantity. A is also a vector quantity. So the resultant acceleration will be the vector sum of the two. And from the law of parallelogram, we know that the diagonal is going to represent the direction, final direction. Let's say it makes an angle theta with the vertical, the resultant direction. So one can easily write using the vector analysis that tan theta is equals to A by G. I hope you understand this. This is the acceleration in this direction. Theta, tan theta is the perpendicular to the base. So this is A by G. If you do the little bit of trigonometry, you will notice that the surface makes the same angle theta with the horizontal. Remember one thing, surface of the liquid always remain perpendicular to the total acceleration experienced by it. If it is acceleration due to gravity, the surface is horizontal. If you try to put the directional change in the acceleration by having pseudo force, the surface will try to adjust itself in such a manner that the final acceleration remains perpendicular to the surface always. So that creates the slant surface. And remember the formula, the angle theta which this surface is making with the horizontal is 10 in use this concept in the these questions later on. Next. Now we are changing from liquid at rest to liquid in motion. There is a very important theorem as attached to the motion of liquid, is known as the equation of continuity. But while watering plants, you might have noticed that if you want to make the water to reach at a distant plant there, what do you normally do? You make the opening of the tube narrow so that it goes with a greater velocity. Because the flow is continuous. Continuous means that there is no gap in between and it's going straight. So in that situation, we have one simple relation that the area of cross-section A1 at the entrance, the velocity V1, this product remains constant throughout. At the exit, we have the area A2, the velocity is V2. Notice one thing, and I want you to record this. Area multiplied by velocity, area multiplied by velocity is equal to the volume flow per unit time and is called rate of flow, is known as rate of flow. This rate of flow is same throughout. This is a volume per unit time, right? This is important. This happens only when the liquid is incompressible and non-viscous, the condition. That means liquid must be ideal. If it is having viscosity and is having some compression, which normally all liquids have, the formula is not applicable in this form. We have to modify it. We have to correct it. Anyway, next. Very important theorem. Bernoulli's theorem. Right? I have a tube having a different area of cross section, having different height. Liquid is passing through it. Once again, the liquid is incompressible and non-viscous, ideal. There are three energy content associated to the liquid. kinetic, potential and pressure energy. But I am writing this as energy per unit volume. But in cheezon ko note karna hai. Energy per unit volume. I am not taking this as energy. I have three contents. One is the kinetic energy per unit volume, potential energy per unit volume and pressure energy per unit volume. Look at this. Kinetic energy formula is half mv square. You divide it by volume. That makes it mass by volume and its density. So half rho v square is kinetic energy per unit volume. Potential energy per unit volume, potential energy normally written as mgh, divide by volume, mass by volume gives you density. So rho gh. Pressure energy is pressure into volume. All of you are aware of the ideal gas equation PV equals to nRT. PV is basically is the total pressure energy of the gas, right? Or maybe a general of fluid. So this always remains constant. Please do accept this equation as if there are three different ways in which the liquid can possess energy. Total always remains same in a particular situation. Maybe one part will increase with time. If one part is increasing, the other part will decrease. Look at this carefully. The tube is going to a greater height. It means the potential energy is increasing. If potential energy is increasing, the other two contents, that means kinetic energy and pressure, the two together, they will definitely decrease by the same amount as is the increase in the potential energy. So it is like a bank account. You are maintaining, say, two or three bank accounts. The total money is same. You are shifting money from one bank account to another bank account. So if one is decreasing, surely the sum of the other two must increase by the same amount. So this way we'll take the care of this Bernoulli's theorem in the questions. Next, sir. There is one of the very important instrument known as a venturi meter. How to measure the flow of the liquid? I have a pipe which is having a greater area of cross-section A1 in the beginning. In the middle part of it, the area of cross-section decreases. And again, it goes to the same value. If I have the vertical tubes attached to it, I find the liquid level in this is less. Why is it less? It is less because the area of cross-section becomes smaller. Velocity becomes more. Why becomes more? Because area into velocity remains constant. If velocity becomes more, the kinetic energy becomes more, then some other energy must decrease by the same amount. So but there is a decrease in the level here as compared to the vertical tubing in the beginning. There is a relation which we can derive from the Bernoulli's theorem. You can easily do it. So this is the area A1, A2, under root of 2gh. Remember, h is a difference in height. Sometimes they give the height for one, height for two. Take the difference and put it there. You can find out how much liquid is flowing through it. It's one of the applications of the Bernoulli's theorem. This equation is also very important. Torricelli's relation. If I have a big container and I make a small hole in the wall of the container, the liquid will come out of it. Why liquid comes out when we have small hole in a container? Again, the Bernoulli's theorem. See, liquid at this point is experiencing the weight of the above liquid and is at a higher pressure. When you open it to the atmosphere, there is a decrease in the pressure. Pressure decreases, increasing the kinetic energy because of which the liquid comes out. So one simple relation. Look, I'm getting the kinetic energy because there is a decrease in the pressure when it comes out. For the liquid which is out from the container, there is no liquid above it. So you can easily write rho gh equals to half rho v square to find out the velocity. Velocity is equals to root 2gh. Do you remember this relation? In motion in 1D, you must have done it when a liquid or when a body is allowed to fall. Right? from the height h, the final velocity becomes under root of 2gh. So similar relation is there, and you can use when it comes out, it then takes a parabolic path to come to the base, covering up some distance horizontally, which we are showing by x, that is called the range. And this range can easily be obtained from the formula from the projectile. So this is the case, projectile case 2 is going horizontally and taking a parabolic path. So this is the relation there. So this is the Torricelli's equation. Again, it's very important, and we'll take one example from the Torricelli's equation also later on. Coming to the viscosity. Viscosity is the basically is the opposition to its own flow. When liquid is allowed to flow, liquid layers are trying to oppose the flow. As a result, what we notice that the layer of the liquid, which is almost near to the surface, is not moving at all, is almost in contact with the surface. The topmost layer is going with the high velocity. And as you move down along this z-axis, you notice that the velocity is continuously is decreasing. So velocity above is more, velocity lower is less, and finally comes to zero. This is what the viscosity is. The rate at which the velocity is decreasing with z is called the velocity gradient. Velocity gradient is the rate at which the velocity is changing with the depth. dv by dz is velocity gradient. Viscous force is directly proportional to the velocity gradient. Also, it is proportional to the area of the layer. More area, more frictional forces. So this is important, that area proportionality and the velocity gradient proportionality. And to link, we have a coefficient of viscosity eta. Why I have a negative sign here? Because it's opposing the motion. It's not helping the motion. It's opposing the motion. That's why we have a negative sign. It's indicative of it. One more thing which is important from viscosity. The unit. The unit is 1 kilogram per meter per second. But normally we measure it in CGS unit, poise. So please do remember the SI unit is 10 times bigger than the CGS unit. You may find the unit given for viscosity or coefficient of viscosity as poise. So when you want to convert it to SI system, so you have to use this type of conversion there. But viscosity poses one problem. Number one, Bernoulli's theorem is not applicable. Why is not applicable? Do you remember condition? That is for the ideal liquid, incompressible, without viscosity. And now you're talking about the viscosity. So when viscosity is there, Poiseuille's gave us a very convenient formula for the liquid which is flowing through a pipe. If there is a pipe of radius r, and at the two ends we have a pressure difference, p, then the rate of flow, once again, rate of flow was volume per unit time. It's here the same. Volume per unit, normally written as q, or may you may use any other symbol also, pi p r4 divided by a theta l. This is a relation which is quite important. Please notice here which quantity is affecting the rate of flow to the maximum. Can you make out? Radius, because it comes with the power 4, right? So if I increase the radius, then definitely the rate of flow is going to change drastically. Viscosity also brings a frictional force for the solids which are passing through the fluid. Stokes' law. Stokes' law given here is for a very specific system, which is spherical. For a spherical body, it is given as 6 pi eta rv. Look, who are affecting it? viscosity of the fluid, radius of the body, and its velocity. Sometimes we say that don't drive your car beyond a certain limit. One point is a safety. There is another point also. If you are going above a certain velocity, you are unnecessarily increasing the force of friction on it. If force of friction is more, you are burning more fuel. It may not be economical then. So this velocity also plays a great role. When you allow this body to fall in a fluid due to friction, it cannot keep on increasing its velocity. There is a limit to it, and we call this velocity as the terminal velocity. Terminal means the end velocity. Now, if you look at the expression, you have to remember this expression, though it's very easy to obtain mathematically. We have two densities here, rho and sigma. Rho is the density of the body, and sigma is the density of fluid. Eta is its viscosity, g is acceleration due to gravity. So the difference plays a great role here. If I have, say, the wooden ball inside the water and I release it, I find that now this velocity is not in the downward direction, rather it will be in the upward direction because of the difference of the velocity there. So we have to keep that in mind. I think this is surface tension. Tension is a force, everybody knows. But surface tension is force per unit length. Do you remember this? Surface tension is not force. It is force per unit length. Iski length? Whose length? Do one simple experiment. Take a beaker like this. Draw an imaginary line on its surface. There are many molecules of water on the surface. All of them are experiencing a force because of the neighbor. That actually brings the surface tension. You count the force divided by the length. That ratio is called the surface tension. You know, the lighter bodies, they normally float. And the bodies having density more than the density of the liquid, they normally sink. Metal, if you have a nail in and you put it in the water, it normally goes down. But have you ever seen metal floating? Or solid matter? I'm not talking about the metal having some, say, cavity in it. If it is a complete solid, is it possible for metal to float on the surface of the liquid? Yes or no? No. Did he float kare to water? But if I say it's iron, then okay, I'll show you a small video. And what I did in that, I took an all pin which is made up of iron. Look, can you stop it here? See, there is an all pin which is lying on this, say, filter paper. When I put a filter paper in the water, it floats, right? What I did, I put an iron all pin on the top of, and very, without much disturbance, I pushed this paper inside the water after some time without disturbing the surface much, and see what happens next. Now look at this. this is floating on the surface of the water. The paper is put to go inside. So this is possible because of the surface tension. I'll give you this. You can try this later. Put a nail, but very, very without much disturbance to the surface. If you can make this paper to go in the water, you will find that the all pin is floating on the surface of the water. How is it possible? Because the surface is behaving as a stretched membrane. If you take a sheet and all of you stand on the side and try to push outward direction, then you can put a load on it, even if the load is having a higher density. So surface behaves as a stretched membrane. That what we will see, that how to handle these type of questions there. Yes. Next, sir. But while solving the problems of the surface tension, you have to be very, very careful. If I ask you, what is the area of this paper? If its radius is R, what is the surface area of this paper? Any formula? If it is circle in shape, what will be its area? Pi R square. It is only from the one side, but also has the other side too. Okay. So the surface area of this paper is in fact 2 pi R square. If I have a line, I have the molecules on this side, I have the molecules on the other side too, and all of them, they are trying to pull it. So while taking the surface tension, look at this carefully. There is another way of doing it. The surface tension is also defined as the potential energy per unit area. But look how I have taken the area here. It is not L into X. You have made this rod to move this way by a distance X. Its length is L, but the area covered is not LX. The area covered is 2LX. This basically is a film of the liquid. LX is from the top, and same LX is from the bottom side too. So this is an important point. You please take care of it. So surface tension can be defined as potential energy per unit area. Right? This will be. These are the few formulas you have to remember. But if liquid surface is free, it is trying to minimize it, because minimum surface area means the minimum energy. Abhi humne dekha beta, potential energy per unit area is the surface tension. So more area means more potential energy. So there is a pressure change from outside to inside. If it is a drop of liquid, the pressure, excess pressure inside is more pressure. It is 2T by R, where T stands for surface tension. We normally use T or sigma for surface tension, the two symbols which are commonly used. But if it is a bubble has two surfaces. How comes? See, if a bubble is having air inside, liquid, so there is one surface from the inner side, air outside, and again a liquid, so there are two surfaces. So because of the two surfaces, the pressure, excess pressure inside is 4T by R. But please remember, I've taken 4T by R, assuming that the thickness of the bubble is not very large as compared to the radius. Otherwise, I should have taken it as 2T by R1 plus 2T by R2. If there is a bubble inside the liquid, another situation, such a bubble is having only one surface. That's why the pressure is only 2T by R. And it's very important to know, if it is a cylindrical surface, see, bubble has a spherical surface. But if it is a cylindrical surface, if you have two slides, put a liquid, then the surface is no more spherical. It takes a cylindrical shape. If it is cylindrical, the pressure should be taken, the excess pressure to the side, inner side, should be taken T by R more. So there should not be any confusion for the excess pressure when you talk about the liquid and so on and so on. Next. Surface tension brings another very interesting thing. The liquid, when you bring it in contact with the say other materials, sometime takes the shape. But this shape which I have shown here, concave and convex, is only applicable when the we talk about say capillaries or thin tubes. You can't see the surface of the liquid concave if it is a broader vessel, but if you look carefully near the wall, you'll find that there is a curve. So water with a glass is having, as mercury with the glass is having the convex surface. There is a point here. If I draw a tangent at the contact point, then this angle which this wall makes through the liquid is contact angle. Dekhi beta, I have taken the angle from the wall to the tangent, but I have taken this angle from the liquid side, not from the air side. Same I did here. If I take a tangent, then angle taken from the solid through the liquid to the tangent is a contact angle, and that is acute, and this is obtuse. Next, sir. Due to this contact angle, liquid normally rises in a capillary. If I have this blotting paper, which is having so many capillaries because of the fiber structure of it, and if I simply put it in the water, I find that with the time, the water starts rising. If you just notice, the water is rising. So if there is a thin capillary, if you put even a cotton thread, you'll find it is continuously is going up. It's a capillary action. The formula you should remember for this is 2t by r rho g cos of theta c, and you be very very clever to remember it. R is not the radius of the surface, it is the radius of the capillary. If you are using the radius of the capillary, you have to use the cos theta c. The theta c is the contact angle there. But if you are using simply the radius of the meniscus, then there is no need to use the cos theta c. I'm repeating my words again. If radius of the capillary is used, small r, you have to use the cos theta c there. But if you know what is the radius of the meniscus, meniscus means the upper surface, then no need to use the cos theta c. And one very interesting thing, if theta c is acute, cos theta c is positive. That means it's, we are talking about the height rise. But the moment theta c becomes obtuse, you know, cos function in the second quadrant is negative. If it is negative, then this height negative means that the liquid will not rise in the capillary, rather will lower down in the capillary. So this formula will take care of both the situations that you have to keep in mind. Next, coming to the mechanical properties of solid, stress and strain, all of you are aware of it. Stress is force per unit area, but which area we should take, that is important. Strain is change of dimension to the original dimension. Which dimension once again is important, and accordingly there are various type of stresses and various type of strains. The first one is a normal stress. If I have a rod, I try to pull it down, it opposes it by putting a force on it. And if you take the force per unit area of cross section, it is normal stress. In the same context, the change of dimension is, which is more important for a rod, is a length. Change of length to the original length is a longitudinal strain. And if you take the ratio of the two, we call this as the Young's modulus. But if I apply the tangential stress, I take a surface and I apply a force on the surface. I'm not trying to increase its dimension, but I'm trying to change its shape. Then I take the force per unit area, but the area on which I'm applying the force. There, more important is the change of shape, the angle it twists. So strain is a shear strain. The ratio is called modulus of rigidity, eta. Don't mix up with these, that what is Young's modulus, modulus of rigidity. They're not different. They have the same dimension. But because you are taking a different stress, different type of strains, so the names are different there. Similarly, we have a pressure stress. If I apply the force from all the side, not in one direction, I have a pressure stress. Similarly, there is a associated to it as a volume strain, because when you have a force coming from all the sides, all dimensions will change, length, breadth, height, all will change. So volume, and the ratio is known as the bulk modulus. Have you noticed a negative sign here? I have not used a negative sign in these. Why so? If you apply force from all the sides, it is going to decrease the volume. It will not increase the volume. This negative sign is indicative, but you should remember that where we are using the negative sign, that makes all these moduli of elasticity never have a negative value. There is another important quantity called the Poisson's ratio. If I increase the length of this rod, if I increase the length of the rod, it is very obvious that its radius will change. This radius change and associated strain is called the transverse strain. If I take the transverse strain and longitudinal strain, this ratio is called the Poisson's ratio. Again, it's negative. Why is it negative? Once again, normal situation we have, when there is an increase of length, there is a decrease of radius. But there are certain material where reverse also is possible. Coming to the next. Hooke's law, applicable only when you talk about the proportionality portion. That means when stress and strain, they are proportional. Say in this region, which we call as the elastic, stress is proportional to strain. That's the Hooke's law. I'm skipping all these things. This is information and it's already there in the e-content there. Next. These relations are important. They are linked with each other and you have to remember them. Young's modulus with bulk modulus, Young's modulus with modulus of rigidity, the relation between all of them, and one very important relation, Poisson's ratio. It can never be more than 0.5. or not even 0.5, and cannot even be less than minus 1. So this is the theoretical limit for Poisson's ratio. You cannot construct any material which will have Poisson's ratio more than 0.5 and less than minus 1. So if somehow you're getting a value of Poisson's ratio beyond this limit, it means something wrong has happened, right? So be careful. Next slide. If I have a beam and I put a load in the middle of it, it bends. How much it bends depends on how much load I am putting. W is the load. If length is large, look again, the power 3. In physics, whenever you remember any relation, please focus additional attention to the power the quantities are raised. Look, from this, I have two things which I can make out. The length is quite responsible for the depression which we have, delta here. And at the same time, I have this thickness. B is the width and D is the thickness. So I should care for the quantity D as in quantity L when I'm talking about the depression. Next one more. Twisting of a rod. If I have a rod and I fix it from one end and I rotate it from the lower end, I'll get the twisting, and this twisting is producing a restoring torque, which is given by this, and again, the R comes with the power 4. These are the hot points for you to remember in mind, that which parameter is affecting more. Most of the time, the questions are like this. They are comparative type. One situation is given to you with which some variation with R is given. They ask for the new situation. So you have to take care of these quantities there. So this is a quick survey of the points, which I'm sure that you are aware of it. Before we proceed to the questions, any doubt from this portion? Any confusion? Shall we go to the problem now? Right? So I've selected few problems. We'll come back to these points if need is there. So first unsolved problem, which we'll solve, is like this. Look, I have three liquids of density rho 1, rho 2, rho 3 piled one over the other. Obviously, they must be the immiscible liquids. One is of height h, other is of height h2, h1, h2, h3. These are the heights given. If the liquid is arranged like this, for example, if I have a water in my beaker and I put some oil on it, it will float. It will not mix with the water. It floats. Some oils are lighter, they float up, or some are heavier, they move down. So I can have this type of the arrangement of various liquids. If I'm looking for the pressure at the bottom, at this end, again, first thought, which pressure? Gauge pressure or absolute pressure? When I talk about the gauge pressure, forget about the atmospheric pressure. That will be the pressure contributed by these liquids only. No way by atmosphere. So you do the summation of the pressure. If I come to this point, the pressure is H1 rho G. Further, if I move down, again, there is an additional contribution coming from the second liquid. It's H2 rho G. And similarly for the third one. So at the bottom, I have the pressure which is summed up H1 rho G, H2 rho 2G, H3 rho 3G. But if I'm talking about the absolute pressure at the bottom, gauge pressure is always there. When we discussed about the pressure, that absolute pressure is gauge pressure plus the atmospheric pressure. You have to add it. So we have the atmospheric pressure there. So whenever they ask for the pressure, please put this question to yourself. Is it the gauge pressure which is doing the work or absolute pressure? And then accordingly, write your answer. Next. This is the problem. What we have here is there's a piston which is having some weight. Right, is an arrangement of tube. It is closed from this end. This fluid is confined fluid. Confined fluid means it can't move here and there. There's no leakage. There's no possibility of any liquid to come in. That means it's confined liquid. And I put a piston there and I find that the liquid here is higher than the liquid there. I'm taking the center just for the simplification. This height is H. And I want to find out the total pressure both at point A as well as at the point B. And the weight of this piston is W. See, next slide. As far as the weight part is concerned, the weight of this piston is putting a pressure on this surface, and as per our definition, it is equals to weight divided by area. But if I move to this point down, as I'm moving down, the pressure is increasing. So it increases by an amount which is equals to H rho G. So one thing is quite clear, that at this particular point, the pressure is H rho G because of this liquid. Now I come to whether I have my piston open to the atmosphere or not. It is open. At least this piston is open to the atmosphere. It is not closed from anywhere. So it means atmospheric pressure is also there. If atmospheric pressure is there, so the total pressure will become P0 contributed by atmosphere, W by A contributed by piston, and H rho g contributed by liquid. But that is for the point A. But why I'm saying the pressure at B is same? Because same level, liquid confined at rest, at the same level the pressure is going to be same. Varna kya hoga beto? Pressure change hoga, the liquid will move from high pressure to low pressure to balance it, right? So this what we normally use, right? There's a similar example of this type. I think you can easily handle it. For a system shown in this figure, the cylinder on the lift at L has a mass M. Yahan beti iska mass M hai, right? And cross-sectional area is capital A. The piston on the right is at S and has a cross-sectional area small a. It's not shown here, but it's small a. But has a negligible weight. So all these points, when you read a question, you please keep on underlying these points, because when he says that we have negligible weight, it means I should not count the weight of the piston as we did in the previous question. If the apparatus is filled with oil of density rho, it's filled with a density rho, find the force required to hold the system in equilibrium as shown in this figure. See, if this is a mass here, obviously this mass will push the liquid in the downward direction. That will make the liquid to go in this tube, and this liquid is trying to go up because this piston is not having any mass. So of course you have to apply the force from top to keep it at its place. How to solve it? What again I'm doing is, I'm taking two points. Try to learn the scheme we are doing. I'm selecting two points just very close to this mass, though there's a gap, but forget about the gap. It is just almost at the bottom of it. And the similar point here, the point B. And what should be same at two points? Pressure. Look what that same I'm doing. This is open to the atmosphere. If it is open to the atmosphere, then we'll have atmospheric pressure there. Mass will produce a weight which is equals to mg to push the liquid downward. A is the area of cross-section. The formula for pressure is force per unit area. If I come to the B side, P0 is there. I'm applying a force from top, but this piston is not having any mass. Forget about it. But there is a liquid column here, H. So that produces additional pressure, which is equals to H rho g. It's here. Now it's a mathematic, and we get the expression for the force. So in these two questions, what we have done, this is a technique. Keep that in mind. When liquid is at rest, you take account of the situation, take that who is responsible for producing a pressure, take two points in the liquid, same liquid, it should not be another liquid on the other side, it should be the same liquid, same level, pressure, the pressure on two sides, and you'll get your quantity of interest. Right? That is the technique. Next question. This is a very famous type of question, YouTube type of questions, right? I have two different liquids. Normally, we have this in mind. If I have a YouTube and I put some liquid from one side, that is true if liquid have the same density. But it may not be true if liquids have different density. Look at this very interesting situation. On this side, we have a liquid of density rho 2. On this side, we have the liquid of density rho 1. And we find that the equilibrium is established at the two different heights. So there is a level difference. It is possible. This is not the same liquid. So situation is different, right? How to solve it? A very simple thing. If you don't find such a level, then take a point from where they are separating. If I take this point, since it is a single point, pressure must be same whether you take it from this arm or you take it from this arm. 8.5, pressure must be same. But from this arm, it is at the height h2 and density is rho 2. From this side, it is height h1, density is rho 1. So you can write h1 rho 1g is equals to h2 rho 2g. I have not taken the atmospheric pressure here. Why I have not taken the atmospheric pressure? Because even if I take it on the left hand side, I have to write P0, that is my atmospheric pressure. On the right hand side also, I have to write the same. So they are normally is removed. So if you want, you can skip it out. It is not necessary. With experience, you'll get all these things and you can easily skip out. So we get the density, if it is required, that is H1 by H2, right? We can get whatever is required from the question side. Yes, sir, next. Yes, now we come to a very serious question. While doing it, I need from your side the concept of calculus, a typical question which normally is asked in IIT JEE. We have a YouTube. Basics are with us now from the previous examples. Now it's a new situation. We are actually, they are mixing up the two. So the normal practice in the IIT questions, they are not asking the question only from one particular topic. They are normally clubbing the two things. This is the YouTube. Let me first of all give you the idea about the question. Is a YouTube having some liquid, one liquid only, of density rho? This is the vertical axis, the center, not passing from the center. From this side, it is R2. From this side, the distance is R1. And whole of this U-tube is rotated with the angular velocity as given is omega. And there is a level difference. From that side, it is H2. And from this side, it is H1. When you rotate this, this level difference appears and is asking, determine the difference of elevation of water in the two tubes. How to handle it? Let's take some simple, say, problem before we handle it properly. If I make a body to rotate, forces we experience, or the body which is rotating is experiencing. I'm giving you one simple example. Take this bob and a thread and make it to move. It can't move in the horizontal plane, but take it in a simple way to understand. But if I'm making it to rotate like this, I feel that this is trying to go away from me. I have to hold it. If I make my grip loose, it will fly away. Let's learn from it. It means that when I put this body in the circular motion, there comes a force which is radially outward. We call this force as a centrifugal force. It's again is a pseudo force. In order to counter this centrifugal force, what I have to do is, I have to hold it. That we call as a centripetal force. Centripetal force is to be provided. Centrifugal force will come automatically. I'm giving you one example. Maybe fighting with your sister or brother in your house, you might have thrown some anything which you find towards your sister or brother. Sometime it some happens so it goes and say, for example, a towel is thrown and then it just stuck in a fan blade. If you are not able to approach that, one simple thing you can do. Switch on the fan. What will happen? When you switch on the fan, fans start rotating and that towel flies away after some time. Obviously, it was experiencing a friction. The moment the centrifugal force becomes more than the friction, it goes away. Knowingly or unknowingly, we are using physics in our day-to-day life. So here we have to keep in mind, centrifugal force will come automatically. Centripetal force we have to provide in order to keep our body in circular motion. I'm giving you one more example. You're traveling in a bus. Unfortunately, you're not finding any seat and you are standing. And it takes a circular turn. What we notice? As if we are getting a push in the outward direction. Nobody is pushing us. There's no one who is pushing us, but only because of the circular motion we are getting this force. So this is what automatically comes and we have to counter it. All right. Take similar situation, not for the U-tube initially, for a tube, horizontal tube. And from there we come to this point once we understand this. Now what I have a tube. I'm taking a simple case. I have a tube filled with some liquid, closed from this end, obviously, otherwise the liquid will flow out. And I make it to rotate. Make it to rotate. With an angular velocity omega, about one of its ends, say A. Right? What will happen? Say at this end B, whole of the liquid is trying to gush out of the tube, but liquid can't do it as it is closed. So it means liquid is pushing a pressure on the wall at B. So obviously it is creating some pressure there. Let's try to get the expression for the pressure, which we'll use to solve this problem. You know the formula for centrifugal force? M R omega square in terms of omega, or you can write M V square by R. But do you know that this formula is applicable only for the point mass, not for the extended mass? This is the concept. See, the formula M R omega square is for the point mass. It is not a point mass. Then what we can do? We can think of a point mass in it. And that is a very simple, and calculus is at our disposal to help us. Look, what I'm doing is, I'm taking a small slice of it. Please treat this as slice, small, though I'm showing it with some width so that you can see it. Say, at a distance x from the axis, the width of this slice is dx. Since dx is approaching to zero, I can treat this as a point mass. Though it's very difficult to grasp this idea that how can such a slice be a point mass? Point mass is one which is not having any dimension. If it is not having any dimension, this is having dimension, we are talking about it. But then I'm honest in saying dx approaches to zero. I'm not saying it's zero. It approaches to zero. You treat this as a point mass. Once you take this as a point mass, let's use the formula for centrifugal force. Say I'm writing this as df. Why I'm writing df? Why not f? Because this is the only contribution coming from this slice only. That's all. I have dm. What is the radius of it? Even if I say the length of this rod is L. its radius is x only, because when it is rotating, this slice is rotating with the radius x. So I use this x, and the angular velocity with which it is going is omega. So I write this as omega square. So this df is the mass of this slice, which I am taking as a point mass, the radius mr, then omega square. This mass, obviously, as I'm moving, is changing. Before I go for integration, I have to put one thought. On right side of my equation, how many variables I have? Check. How many variables are there? X, agreed. What about omega square? I'm saying is uniform, so it's not variable. X is variable number one. What about dm? Obviously is variable. I cannot proceed for integration if I have two variables. I have to make some arrangement to put it into one, and then I go for the integration. Whenever you use calculus, you try to have these thoughts in your mind that how many variables we have? Two, three, let's club them to one and go for the integration. Look how I'm doing. I say that the mass of this whole liquid, say, is capital M. Mass of the whole liquid is capital M. If I take the entire length, the mass of the liquid is capital M. If I take unit length, obviously using a unitary method, you can say it is mass per unit length. Sometimes we call it as a linear mass density also. But my system has only the length which is equals to dx. So what is the mass of my element? Dx, I have to multiply with this, is ml dx. You got this? So what I did actually, I converted my variable dm in terms of the x. And if I replace it here, I will get only one variable. And now my equation is fit so that I can go. I do that. I write this as df. Dm now I am replacing as m by l. Dx I am writing here for simplification, omega square x. Once you reach to this level, then only use the integration. If I use integration on both sides, I have to think of the limits also. At this end, there is no liquid starting from zero to the force, net force F at the B, which I'm looking for, capital F. But for this point, my X value is zero. And for this end, it's L. Agreed? If I do that, it is F M L omega square are constants. They can be taken out of integration. X integration, you know, is X square by two. X square by two from the limit from zero to L. Zero will give you zero finally. So this comes out to be F M L omega square. 2 will be here, and this x will change for the, now if I put the limit is as L square. So one of the L can be removed, and I have this formula, half M L omega square. You got this? Actually, I was looking for the pressure. If the area of this tube is A, for example, then the pressure can be obtained as pressure is equals to force per unit area, and I can write this pressure as half M L omega square by A. Is this derivation clear to all of you? Why I'm doing a particular step is very important to understand. It is not that you should remember that how it's done. Must also understand why it's done in this way. Right? When we get a result, we sometime work out shortcuts from it. Look, instead of going for all whole of it, I have one simple thing. My variable is x with the power 1. So quantity changing is in a linear fashion. For linear fashion, instead of doing whole of it, I can do one thing. Don't think of the whole of it. Think of the center of it, or rather the center of mass of it. Treat as if whole of it is present at its center of mass. The whole mass of the liquid is present at the center of mass. If it is present at the center of mass, so this distance is going to be how much? L by 2. It's a uniform distribution, so it must be at the center. Whatever the force is exerted by whole of it is now exerted by this point mass, which I have taken as a at the center because the function is linear. L by 2 going with velocity omega, I can simply write the centrifugal force is the whole mass m, the radius, and the radius is L by 2 now. L by 2 omega square. Look at this result. See, sometime we can days, no need to go through the whole of the process. If you can keep in mind that how your functions are changing, we sometime can reach the result in a simpler way. Use these type of the things so that you can save time in solving those problems where you really require time to do. So by central mass, we can do it easily. In my solution here, we are give you an idea and shortcut you can always try, right? So with this background, I think now we are ready to solve this problem. Shall we go to the solution? Next, please. See what we are doing now. Once again, I'm taking a slice. I'm taking a slice of this liquid at a distance r from this axis. Dr. As this whole of it, this is rotating, so definitely this has been pushed in this direction. Since it is pushed in this direction, so as we have discussed, it is going to generate a pressure. Say at its two ends, the pressure is P and P plus dP. Since it is elementary slice we have taken, so I'm saying the pressure increment is very small, that is equals to dp. How to go for it? Now I use that concept. When it is in circular motion, there must be a centrifugal force on it, and that is to be balanced by the centripetal force. Look, this pressure difference is responsible for the force in the outward direction because of this circular motion. How to write the centrifugal force? Look at this expression carefully. If I say that the area of cross section is A, capital A, density is rho, right? And dr is its length. So its mass can be written in this manner. The mass of this element can be written as dm, the volume multiplied by density. Area of cross section of the pipe multiplied by its length, that is the dv. And if I multiply it by density, I'll get the mass of it. How much will be the centrifugal force? The formula is the same. M R omega square. The mass is dm. Radius is r omega square. So this is going to be the centrifugal force on the element. Mass can be replaced as a dr rho. If I put it a rho dr r omega square, this is nothing but the same expression as we have here. Look at this, a rho r omega square dr. So I am counting the centrifugal force which is acting on this element, which is trying to take it away from the center. But who is balancing it? It is not moving. It is not going. Who is managing it to be there? The centripetal force. How comes this? At this end, the pressure is P. At this end, the pressure is P plus dP. So from this side, I'm getting more pressure. So that generates the centripetal force. You know, the force is the pressure multiplied by area. Area of cross section, right, in this case. So this is what exactly we are doing. The pressure is P plus dP from this side. Pressure is P on this side. Here I want to make one point. Please don't get confused by these arrows. Pressure is not a vector quantity. But the force produced by the pressure is a vector quantity. Force produced by the pressure is a vector quantity. So these arrows are not indicating the pressure. They're actually indicating the force generated by the pressure. This is more, this is less. So whatever is the difference, that difference is P plus dP minus P dP. And multiplying it by area of cross section gives me the centripetal force. So first equation which I have written is basically is the equation centrifugal force is equals to the centripetal force, so that the balance can be made and this liquid remains at its place. You got the point? From here, AA will go, and we are left with dP is equals to rho omega square r dr. How many variables we have in this now? Check. Do we have one variable here? Rho is constant. Density is we assume to be constant. Omega square is constant. He says that it's going with a uniform circular motion. So they are constant. So only r is a variable. So now this equation is fit for integration. If I do the integration from, say, this end, from end 1 to end 2, because that is my interest, so I will write this as P1 minus P2. Please, this is a small error here. It's P1 minus P2. It's a pressure difference. Rather, please change this as P1 minus P2. Please don't take it as P1 minus P1. It's wrongly written. Now, if I do the integration RdR, this must be going from this end to this end. If this is my axis, then on this side I take that as negative, and on this side I am taking this as positive. So if it is minus R2 to R, P1 minus P2 is equals to rho omega square by 2, because this R will then generate R square by 2, and putting the limits will generate R1 square minus R2 square. And as we know that the pressure can be written as H rho g. So replacing it, I will get H1 minus H2. It's actually H1 minus H2. So that is equals to omega square by 2g R1 minus R2. Is this problem is clear to you? Let me summarize this problem in quick of the movement. So what is done? The properties of material, the concept of pressure is mixed with the circular motion. Concept was that when the liquid is made to move, it will try to go out, and if you restrict it, confine it, it will generate pressure. So I use the centrifugal force concept to find out the force. Dividing it by area gives me the pressure. How I did it? Using a mathematics, using the calculus. Remember, whenever there is a formula, you please try to see whether it is for the point mass or for a system. If it is for a point mass, then you have to go for a calculus to help to get the whole contribution of the system. I think it's clear. Any doubt for this problem? Yes. There is another case here. This very special vessel, which is rectangular in shape, having the base size as LB. L is shown to you, and you have to make an imagination that B is the depth. So the base area is L this side and B inward. All right? He says that consider a vessel of the base area LB filled with the water to the height equals to H, as shown. Then find the force acting on the base. Find the force by the liquid acting on the vertical wall. And find the position of the point of application of the force. The last one we'll discuss it in a minute. It's again is linked with the rotational motion. But let's first of all handle the force two and force on the wall, right? See, bottom has one simplification. It's the same level, horizontal level. So pressure here, pressure here, pressure here. Everywhere the pressure is same. How much? H rho g, capital H rho g. H is the total height. So pressure here is capital H rho g. How much is the area of the base? L into B. So multiply and get the force. That is too simple in this case. That is, of course, a trivial one. But when we come to the wall, we find there is a bit of problem. What's that? The pressure is not constant. Pressure at the top is zero. Pressure here is zero. And pressure at the base is equals to H rho g. Got it? So when you have this variation, getting calculus to help you, and when you use calculus, you have to start with by taking some element, and I do the same. I take a strip again, right? This dh is going inward to the other end. I'm taking this strip so small of, say, the depth dh, I can treat this strip to be a point mass. This is how the calculus we use. The pressure at this depth, which is equals to h, is equals to h rho g, right? H rho g is the pressure, right? And what's the area of that strip? Its width is dh and length is b. So it's multiplied dh with b. But from here, what we are doing is we are writing the pressure multiplied by area, but not for whole of the wall, but for a small portion of the wall. How many variables I have here? One, is it fit for integration? Go for the integration. If I do the integration from top to the bottom, I have to cover whole of the wall. That is from zero to H, and that will give you the answer. I have an alternative method also. What is the average pressure on the wall? I gave you in the theory part. That was nothing but the half of the bottom. So the pressure at the bottom is H rho g. So average pressure on the wall, therefore, is equals to H rho g by 2. Agreed? Shortcut, let's use it. Multiple choice questions. We are not going to give the method. Steps nahi dene. H rho g by 2 is the pressure on the wall. And what's the area of the wall? This height is H and depth is B. H into B, multiply with H into B. Look, the same expression. No need to use integration. It doesn't mean that everywhere we have to use integration. See, in previous question also, I told you, whenever the variation goes linear, you can do that with averaging, right? Problem starts when the variation is not linear. With a power 2, with power half, there you have to think. But there are still some methods of handling it. But you must keep in mind how the variation is going on. Once you get the question, you start doing the question. No, think first. What is the best approach to get it? It may not be the straightforward thing. And try to understand even the tricks he is playing. In the question, you keep everything in mind. Don't simply go for integration, right? Some people say that, okay, let's start with integration. No, why we should do it? If we are sure that the variation is nonlinear, then we'll go for it. Otherwise, we'll take it average. Right? In physics, we use these techniques to get that answer in a better way. Now come to the C point. There is a concept here, point of application of the force. What is the meaning of this? Point of application actually is related to the moment. Moment of the force. Moment means torque of the force. Torque, I hope everybody you know, force multiplied by the perpendicular distance in a simple way, though it's very complicated. If I look at this, on the top, the pressure is zero. And as I move, the pressure is continuously is increasing. And what the liquid is trying to do? It is trying to push the wall. And when it is pushing the wall, it is producing a torque. This concept is very important when we build dams. So if I have a dam, I must understand where is the point of the force, the net force we are getting. I cannot simply take it as at the center. Why not? Let's check it. Here, the pressure is zero. I'm saying pressure is zero. What I mean by this is, if atmospheric pressure is from this side, atmospheric pressure also is from the outer side of the wall. So I'm taking only the contribution of the fluid, not of the air involved in it. As I'm moving down, the pressure is increasing. And as pressure is increasing, distance also is increasing. So I'm getting two variables. Pressure is also increasing. Depth also is increasing. And when we talk about the movement, movement is force multiplied by the perpendicular distance. If it is perpendicular distance, both of them are changing. Definitely, it is not linear. So it's never going to be at the center, number one. And in the options, if you find that they have given the center, the bottom, or top, and the fourth option, so if three are rejected, the fourth one will be your answer. Okay? We always keep on looking like this. We want you to be intelligent. Right? Okay, how we do it in a normal practice? Let's see. So what I'm doing is, a previous slide, just for a minute, previous one. See, the movement of force, and if I divide movement of force by force, I'll get the distance. Remember, movement of force is force multiplied by the perpendicular distance. So if I sum up whole of the movement and then divide it by the total force, I'm going to get the distance which I'm looking for. That is called the point of force, where the force is supposed to be acting. How do I get the movement? For a small element, it is nothing but the depth, h, and the force which is acting at this place, df. And it should be integrated from 0 to h. But if I look at this particular situation, both of them are changing. H and f both are changing. So since both are changing, I have no other option but to somehow find out their values and to get one variable. This is what I am doing in the next step. See, this is what we are doing is hdf divided by f. See, how I have written the df relation was already given to you, right, in the previous case. So df has been written, and I find now my integration is in the single variable h. Ek h aaya tha from this df. If you look at the expression for df, you have h there. So now it's h square. H square means it's quadratic. And I'm going from 0 to capital H. Obviously, this is H cube by 3. And if you put H cube by 3 and simplify, because already you know, already we have worked out, right, on the wall. So that gives me that C is equals to 2 by 3 of H. Okay? Why it is below the midpoint? A question may... You must understand why it is 2 by 3. It is nearly 66.66% from the top. From the center, it is on the lower side. Why? Because the liquid on the lower side is putting more force and is also having greater distance from the top. Greater distance, greater force. So the liquid at the bottom is providing more movement. That's why you might have seen, if you look at the cross section of the bridges are thick from the lower side, because that liquid is putting large amount of movement and we have to counter it. So we make it thick, right? This is how the logic goes. Next problem. This is another problem where we are using calculus. Any doubt from the previous question? Sorry, I forget to ask this. No problem. Shall we go to the next one? Good enough. No, please. Previous one. Sorry. I didn't tell the problem. There is a sheet. There's a sheet which is put in the liquid like this at certain angle theta with the horizontal. It says that the force acting per unit width. See, whenever you read the question, you please underline something which appears to be slightly different from normal. Because sometimes you have to read the question twice or thrice to understand what is asked. So if you underline such thing, is very important. He's not asking only force. What is asking? Force per unit width. And width is B. Width is again B. It's a sheet. It's a rectangular sheet like this in the liquid. Says force per unit width on the plane wall inclined at an angle theta with a horizontal as shown in the figure. Now this time the wall is not vertical. Wall is at certain angle. I told you the relation for the force and pressure. If you remember, the relation was df vector is equals to minus p dA vector. Area vector is always perpendicular to surface. If I similarly make a sheet like this, a strip, I'm not going to get the force in the horizontal direction. Please notice this point first of all. If it's inclined, then I'm not going to get the force in the horizontal direction. I'm going to get the force in a perpendicular direction, because the relation was df vector is equals to minus p dA vector, and dA vector is perpendicular to the surface. So if I take this strip, the area vector will be in this direction to this, number one, right? However, the pressure generated by the liquid is due to gravity. If it is generated by the gravity and that is vertical, so always I take it in this way. H is a vertical depth. So pressure at this point is definitely is going to be H rho g. But since I have taken this distance on the inclined side as y, so I have to get a relation between H and y. And using a simple trigonometry, because angle theta is given to you, it is with the horizontal, you write sine theta. The side which is in front of the theta is always a perpendicular. And perpendicular means sine theta. So I have this H is equals to y sine theta. Right? Next step. Now what to do? The pressure, as we have discussed, because of this H, pressure is equals to H rho g. But H I am changing to y as y sine of theta. So what is my df then? My df will be the area of the strip which is having a thickness dy, and the width is b. So what I did, I'm multiplying the dy with this is a depth, and thickness is equals to the dy multiplied by y, and which of course I have to sum up. It's not been summed up here. The pressure given is H rho g, and df therefore is given as rho g by sine theta, this must be v dy. Please take it as dy. Yeah, I missed somewhere to write d here. It is dy. That is the area. Now, once again, if I look at this dy here and y, I have one variable. Now it's fit to go for the integration. But look how I am integrating it. I'm not integrating it from 0 to h. Why I'm not doing it? Because my variable is y. And the variable y from here to here, if you look at this using h by sine theta, it's not h sine theta. So integrating from 0 to h sine theta, dy I have replaced here, and I get this answer. Is this clear? So but here the concept is that the force always is acting perpendicular to the surface. Next. This is very old, but still is used, siphon. If you have a drum full of mobile oil, you cannot always take out the oil by simply putting some container of a technique there. Though we have some mechanical arrangement again at point B, take it simple way. This arrangement is called siphon. I have a container, liquid is filled in it. I have a tube here, which is initially having no air in it. I create low pressure by sucking the air from this side. And if the air, whole air is sucked and whole of it is filled with the liquid, then when you leave it, the liquid will start coming by its own. Right? How is it possible that the liquid will rise first and will come? I have never seen anybody going up by its own. There must be something, some pressure difference which is doing it. We can't have anything going up by its own. So what the question demands, question says that find out the velocity of the fluid which is coming from the section is A, right? That will add from our side. And find the pressure at the highest point B, at this point. And then we have to find out the pressure at the point C also, that is almost at A. Now what to do? Can I use the previous concept of pressure equal? No. Why not? Because those concepts were applicable when the liquid is at rest. And here we have the movement. Liquid is coming out of the siphon. It means the liquid is in motion. Anything given regarding the viscosity here? No. Nothing is mentioned. Treat this as an ideal liquid. And to handle it, we have the best equation, Bernoulli's equation or Bernoulli's theorem. I'll use the Bernoulli's theorem to do it. Let me remind you, Bernoulli's theorem says three energies, kinetic, potential, and pressure. Three together must remain constant. If one is increasing, the other two in total will decrease by the same amount, right? That's the concept. So we'll be using the Bernoulli's theorem. When you look at the question, you have to decide in as less time as possible. How should I approach it? The question is of motion of the liquid. Now there are two things. When the liquid is in motion, I can handle it by Bernoulli's theorem. I can handle it by Poiseuille's formula. I can handle it by Bernoulli's theorem when viscosity is not there. But if the viscosity is there, I can't use the Bernoulli's theorem. I have no other option but to use the Poiseuille's formula. So that is a decision-making point. So when you look at the question, you have to make this decision yourself, right, at that time. So we are applying the Bernoulli's equation at point 1 and 2. And if we do that, see what I'm doing. At point 1 and 2, I'm writing all the three. See, this is the pressure, energy per unit volume, and dividing by rho g as a whole. The whole equation is divided by rho g. P1 rho g, V1 divided by, actually this was half rho V square, if you remember it. It was half rho V square. And if you divide it by rho G, we'll get 2G in the denominator. Actually, this term is called the pressure head. This term is called velocity head. And this term is called the gravitational head. And all of them are lengths. So I'm equating the two. But let's look at this carefully. This point is important. This one. Can we go to the previous slide? Previous slide. See, this was the point one, and we have taken the point two. This is open to the atmosphere, right? And this is also open to the atmosphere. I can safely say the pressure at one is P0, and pressure at two also is P0. But if I am only concerned with the fluid, I'm not talking the air as we have done in the previous question also. We ignored the atmospheric pressure. You can easily do it. So I'd say that the pressure at one is zero because of the fluid. And pressure at two also is zero because of the fluid. Got the point? Remember, this height is H3, this is H2, and that one is H1. So you have to keep that figure in mind, right? Go to the next one. So I have written P1, P2 is equals to P0, which will obviously will go from both the sides. Y1 is zero. Why Y1 is zero? Go to the previous one. Why Y1 is zero? Y1 is the height. Remember, Y1 was gravitational head. Now here is a concept which you must remember. If I write the potential energy as mgh, I have to decide my reference. If I say, you tell me, students, what is the potential energy of this pen? What is the potential energy of the pen? Mgh. If height is not much, h is the height. Whether I take the height from this table or I take the height from the ground, I have to decide first of all. It's my wish. I can take, but I have to mention it. Y is the gravitational head in my case. I'm taking the height of the point one as my reference. I'm taking the point one as my reference, and reference height is always taken as zero. That's why the Y1 is zero. You could have taken any value, and accordingly, if you have made the corrections, it is going to give you the same result. But look, the height of one is zero. If I take like this, what is the height of the point two? It is not the height, rather it is a depth. It is H2, H3, but on the lower side. That's why we use the negative sign for this. Next slide, sir. This is what I have done. You got it? Now I have to think about the velocity also of one and two. What is the velocity of the top surface? Assuming it to be very wide, I assume this to be zero. Let me tell you, it's not going to be zero perfectly. But if the container is very large and siphon tube is not very large in size, then the velocity at the end can be taken as zero, right? To approximation. So V1 is zero. Rest is mathematics. You just put the values. You'll find the P0 will be out from the scene, from that side. Because if you write P0 here, these two terms will go. Even if you do not use them, there is not going to be any problem, as we have discussed. So we get the velocity V2. Similarly, you can apply the Bernoulli's equation for point one and B. I'm leaving this part for you. Again, you have to use the similar concepts to get the thing done. Next one. Go to the next one. They can do it now. So here is another type of problem, and that is based on Torricelli's equation. So we discussed, let me sum up, we discussed the concept of pressure, Pascal law, a problem from Pascal law, where we have used many different ways to get the things done, mixed up with the rotational motion. Previous one was from Bernoulli's theorem, and this is from the Torricelli's equation. For Torricelli's equation, let me ask you to remember one point in your mind. so that when we use it, if this is a container and this is at the depth h, the liquid will gush out from it with the velocity which is equals to 2gh. Rho is missing from here. Rho is missing from here. And this h is not taken from the bottom. It is taken from the top, free end, free surface. Right? These are the points you should not forget while using it. The question says this. There is a container with the wheels, no friction. Let me not make it very complicated. There is a hole at the bottom from where the liquid will gush out. It is just like one direction, we get a push in the opposite direction. This is a basic principle of the rocket. You assume to be very large, this to be very large, right? So when the liquid goes in this direction, this acquires a velocity in this direction, and this is what he is asking. Friction is negligible. Let's not take friction. One can always do the friction. And the liquid is decreasing, level is decreasing, and when it reaches at the middle, he wants to know that what is the velocity at that end. Okay, is clear? Next one. So how to get the velocity? We have to use the laws of motion. Force equals to mass into acceleration. Now, the mass which is in motion, tank, which is water tank, it's not having its own mass, it's the water only having, but there is a problem. This y, that is the height of the liquid in the tank, is not constant. Why is not constant? As the liquid is going out, the height is decreasing. This mass is written simply the density into volume, but this y is variable, keep it in mind. And at the same time, we have the velocity dv by dt. This also is variable. Why velocity is variable? Because from this relation, as this height is decreasing, that means the y. So velocity depends on y. This is a relation. But this velocity is with respect to tank. If anyone is in the tank, say our imaginary observer is in the tank and liquid is going out. If liquid is going out, so he says that velocity is equals to c. Velocity is c. Right? Now, when we write the force equation, this is the velocity which is changing. Density, the A. Can we go to the previous slide just to show that what is A? A is this area with which it is going out. A is the area. Do you remember I told you area multiplied by velocity is the volume flow per unit time. See, quickly give me what is the second law. Second law is not only mass into acceleration. Please take it carefully. It is dp by dt. So if I say that some movement is changing, that means there is a force. All right? So if from a particular area, some liquid is going out, the volume flow per unit time, I told you, is equals to AV. The volume which is going out is equals to AV. If I multiply by density on this side, what do I get? Density multiplied by volume is the mass multiplied by time. That means dm by dt. And if I further multiply by velocity once, I'm going to get nothing but the force. So next one. So this what exactly is done here? Density into area of cross section multiplied by velocity squared. The velocity with which it is going is c. So it's taken as c squared. And from this expression, right, we get this 2 rho A gy. And when you compare, we get dv by dt easily. That is equals to 2 ga by capital A. Next one. In small interval of time, how much mass you are losing? See, we are losing some mass with which the level of the water is coming down. The area of the tank is capital A. The rate at which this depth is changing is dy. So minus rho A dy is the rate at which this mass is going out. A is the area and dy is the depth. So that gives me the volume. And which is equals to A, rho A C dt. This is the volume from the tank lowering down. And this is the volume when it is going out. Rho A multiplied by C is the volume in time dt. Out from the orifice, and the level which is decreasing must be same. But only one thing is that one is decreasing and the other is going out. So that's why we are using a negative sign here. So but now we have dv by dt. What cleverly we have done is that we have multiplied by dy, denominator as well as numerator. This helps me in one way. Dv into dt, I can easily write this as dy. I can take that on the other side. And this 2ga by a related to the previous relation gives me this. And then finally on integration, I get the velocity relation. Okay, so what I'm doing, the liquid which is going out from the orifice and the liquid which is flowing down, that must be equated. And from there, we get these relations. Next question. This already I have shown you a bit. This is from the buoyancy, Archimedes principle. I have this type of a spring balance. This is a beaker, as I told you. We have this type of an object. Lower down. When I put it in the spring balance shows or record the lowering of the weight of this body. And what this is doing, that you have checked, right? There was an increase in the weight and the increase in the weight. So read the option B and C. There are questions where you have to have many options. So when you have many options, then you have to select all of them. Check first of all and see how many of them are correct. Let's check it one by one. The balance A, first reads, the balance A will read more than 2 kg. This is the balance A. It cannot read more than 2 kg because of the buoyant force. It will read always less. A is out. The balance B will read more than 5 kg because 3 kg is mass of this. So obviously this will read more than 5 kg. We checked it ourselves. And I told you this is because of the Newton's third law. If buoyant force in upward direction, then reactionary force will be in the downward direction. So this B is correct. The balance A will read less than 2 kg. That is correct because of the buoyant force. And last one, the balance A and B will read 2 kg and 5 kg respectively. This is not possible. It means you are ignoring the buoyant force. This is not possible. So A and D are ruled out. B and C are correct. Let me, why I have taken this question. Yes, there is a reason for it. Understand this. When there are multiple correct answers, it is not that we have to reach the right one and that is sufficient. No. We have to correct what are right options, but we must check the others are incorrect. It's a double effort which you have to do. So whenever you have multiple answer correct, you have to go through each and every option step by step, right? Next question. Again from the point C1. It's a very famous question, many times asked in many examination, though the purpose is only to give you an idea. There is a hemispherical portion of radius R removed, but a cylinder, there is a cylinder and hemispherical portion is removed. It's empty from here. The volume of the remaining cylinder is V. Whole of this cylinder now has a volume V. It is suspended by a string in a liquid of density rho, where it stays vertical. The upper surface of the cylinder is at the depth H. Below the liquid surface, find the force on the bottom of the liquid. It's empty from this side, and I have to get the force. Now try to understand first of all the problem. I can do it by having concept of pressure. Pressure is force into force divided by area. So force is pressure into area. I can say, okay, pressure at this level, and then I have to multiply it by the area. Problem is, what is the direction of the force? Direction is perpendicular to the surface, I told you. And in a spherical surface, the direction is radial. Radial means passing through the center. In this direction, in this direction, in this direction. So there are many directions possible. When you have so many vectors, things becomes really very complicated to handle. It is not that easy. If it is a multiple type choice of question, then is it possible to handle it by some alternative method? If you stuck to this, that okay, if I try this method and it seems to be a lengthy one, why not I do it by some alternative way? And we have a very simple and alternative way. Next slide, sir. I do one thing. I want to know the force at the bottom. I have one thing in mind. From the bottom, I'm getting a force in the upper direction, that is true. Right? Because liquid is pushing. But from, I'm getting the force in the inward direction. So there is one force in the upper direction, there is one force in the downward direction. Whatever is surplus is the buoyant force. Whatever is surplus is the buoyant force. The whole of this structure is pushed in the upper direction. How to do it? Let's take, first of all, what is the force on the top? The radius R is given. If radius is given, I can say that the area here is pi R square, and pressure is H rho G. So I have taken this force. I do not know this force, which I require. F is a force in the upper direction. If I know this much is the force, the difference is going to be the buoyant force. And buoyant force is nothing but, is according to Archimedes' principle, is the volume of the liquid displaced. Since its own volume is V, density is rho. So V rho G, and I can get the value of F by shifting this here, that's all. Right? But if, first of all, we must understand the difficulty level. If I straight away approach it from pressure to area concept, because of the direction aspect, I'll stuck up, I cannot do the integration. You are not told how to handle the vector integration if they are in many directions. If they're in one direction, there is no problem. So we have to search for the alternative way. So if you have this concept in mind, the buoyant force comes because from the lower end, the force is coming in upper direction. From the upper end, it's coming in the downward direction. And the difference is the difference in, say, the force is the buoyant force. We can easily handle it. Right? So this is a technique to handle it. Next. Now coming to the material science, material part. Again, as I told you, they try to mix up the concepts. If I apply a force on a rod, I can make it its length to decrease. Or if I apply the force in outer direction, I can make it its length to increase. Suppose a rod is held in a this and you heat it. What do you expect will happen? If you heat some rod, this is definitely is going to make it to get elongation. But you are not permitting it. You are holding it. You are not permitting it to expand. So definitely what will happen? Inside the rod, some tension will appear. So he's asking for that. Mixing the two concepts. A metal wire of length L and area of cross-section capital A is clamped between the two rigid supports. For the material of the rod, the Young's modulus is Y, and the coefficient of linear expansion, this is a thermal linear expansion, is alpha. If temperature of the rod is increased by delta T, the force exerted by the rod on the spout is equal to the force which the rod will exert on the spout, or the same force is exerted by the spout on the rod, can be calculated. How can we do it? Look. In thermodynamics, formula with you. L T is equals to L0 1 plus alpha T. You remember this formula? What is alpha here? Coefficient of linear expansion. Or if you be more appropriate, you can say it is a temperature coefficient of linear expansion. I'm doing it in this way. L T is equals to L0 plus L0 alpha T. Can I write like this? If I take this L0 on this side, this is LT minus L0, L0 alpha T, agreed? Take L0 on this side, LT minus L0 divided by L0 is equals to alpha T. But can you recognize this? This is nothing but is a change in length divided by the original length. Try to link it with the mechanical properties. This is nothing but is a strain. Okay? How I am linking the expansion of the rod, the extent to which it has been increased, divided by original length as a strain. This will help me to put it to the mechanical property. And what's that? Force per unit area is Young's modulus multiplied by strain, the change in length to the original length. See, this is the formula. This is nothing but the Hooke's law. Stress is directly proportional to strain. I am able to get the change in length to the original length. So, but I can just directly link it. F by A is equals to Y, and in this case is alpha T. Change in temperature can be written as delta T also, as he has given. But this is the force YA alpha T. In our case, T is delta T as he had mentioned. So I can write my formula YA alpha delta T. But by this question, I want to teach you how to bridge the two different concepts, which appears to be very, very different. Thermal physics is different and elastic properties are different. How they are clubbed? So there must be some link relation between the two. So this type of link relation you can use from this one. Of course, the moment you see this question, you will get an idea the temperature and elastic property somehow is to be handled, because he has given you the Young's modulus, he has given you the alpha. So the immediately in the mind, the force per unit area is equals to Young's modulus into strain. Strain, yes, the strain is a change in length which is possible through heating process. So bridge the two. Is it clear? Shall we go to the next one? Yes. Answer is there anyway. Can you do it without even writing? Do it on your tips, if possible. Some questions are such where you need not to even use your pen. Use your brain. A1 V1 is equals to A2 V2. Reach to a right. Very good. Then V2 is equals to A1 V1 divided by A2. This is the thing. He says that A1, the radius is 2R. If radius is 2R, what about the area? Square. Remember this 4. Pi R square. And at the second place, it is pi R square only. So we have a 4 in the numerator. So my answer will be 4B. Kabhi kabhi, you can use this type of a technique also. Why to use pin? Every time it is not that you have a formula and you start doing it. It's a simple one. Some questions are simple, some are difficult. True. It's like a garden with many type of flowers, and we have to understand that how to handle these flowers. Okay, next one. Karu, say, do it. Two concepts are there. I'm asking you to find out the work, but giving you information from surface tension. How can I link the two? Can work be linked with energy? Think, there is a theorem, and that is known as work energy theorem. Energy is nothing but the potential energy of surface tension. And for that, I have written one formula. Potential energy, or you can say the surface energy anyway, there's one and same thing. Divide by area was nothing but was tension, surface tension rather, not tension. So surface energy will be equals to A into T. T can be altered if you change the composition or temperature. But in this case, the focus is on area. So I do like this. Change in the surface energy, surface tension multiplied by change in area. Which area I'm talking about? The surface area. This change in energy is nothing but is equals to work according to my theorem, work energy theorem. If I'm increasing the surface energy, I have to do the work. Surface tension multiplied by the surface area. What is the surface area of a bubble if its radius is r? Surface area of a sphere, 4 pi r square, one side only, 8 pi r square. If it is 8 pi r square, can I write this as 2 pi d square? Because diameter is 2 r, square will give me 4, that is 8 pi r. This is what exactly is used here, pi, the diameter square. Since you are changing it from D to 2D, so you have to take this 2D whole square, that is surface area, and I'm multiplying it with the surface tension. But what I have done, and he says that this is the bubble which is going from D to 2D. Pi D square, 2 common is taken out, and if you simplify, your answer will be 6 pi D square into T. It means that if I have a bubble and I want to expand it, I have to increase its surface energy. And for this surface energy, I have to do work on it. Right? Mixed question, right? Mixed type of question. Can you guess the two chapters involved in this? There is a bubble at the bottom of the lake, and it's been taken to the surface of it. It expands. Why it expands? A bubble in the bottom of the lake is taken to the surface, it expands. Why it expands? Because pressure is less on the surface. It means there is a change of pressure. I have to use the concept of pressure. But what he is saying? He says one thing. The atmospheric pressure is equal to that of the column of the water of 5 equals to H. It means I can't ignore this time the atmospheric pressure. See how we handle it. Let there be a lake. Please take this as lake anyway. The bubble goes from here to here and doubles the size. If I say the volume is V and size is 2R here, what will be the volume of this bubble? Initially, the radius is R. Here it is 2R, as been said, radius is double. If volume is V here, and what is volume here? 8V. Why is 8V? Volume is 4 by 3 pi R cube. See, in these type of question, in preparations, we have to use more mind than the writing skill, right? Radius is R. Here the radius is 2R. Volume is 4 by 3 pi R cube. R cube means the factor of R with power 3. So 2 power 3 is 8. 8V. Straight away. And he says one thing. That is taken slowly. This term is very important. Any change which is slow change can be taken as isothermal change. Any change which is very fast is more likely than adiabatic change. Right? Slow change is more likely isothermal because you are giving sufficient time for heat to go out. And when it is slow change, I can assume the temperature to remain constant. If temperature is constant, I have P1 V1 is equals to P2 V2. Kaun sa law hai? Which law is this? Boyle's law. Boyle's law. When temperature is constant, we have P1 V1 equals to P2 V2. P1 here, pressure. Can you tell me how much is the pressure here? Pressure here is the atmospheric pressure plus capital H rho of G, because of the height of this liquid. And volume is V here. What is the pressure at the top of it? Only the atmospheric pressure. Only atmospheric pressure. No column of the liquid. And how much is the volume? Volume is 8V. But if I simplify this, V is out from here. 8P0 and P0 coming here will give me how much? H rho G is equals to 7P0. And what he has written for P0 atmospheric pressure, look at the, he says, is H column of water. H column of water. Luckily, the density here and density here is same, but you have to be always careful for this. H rho G. And if you simplify, rho G is out. And what is the height? I must call this as H dash so that there will be no confusion. H dash, that is equals to 7H. That's your answer. C is your answer. Are you getting the technique? My main concern is that you should understand the techniques to reach at this place, right? Next one, I just only two or three more maybe. Achha, now this is a very typical question. Yeah, this is a typical one and very famous one. Means like fashion, there are certain questions which are asked many times. So I must say this is a question which is in fashion now. What he says, n drops of water of radius r each coalesces to form a big drop of radius r. So the drops, they combine and give you a big drop of r. Surface tension of water is T. The specific heat is 1 calorie per gram for water. Find the rise in temperature, J is given to you. J is nothing but is a Joule's mechanical equivalent. Right? Why there is a rise in temperature first of all? When drops, they all combine. Why there is a rise in temperature? First point to understand. You know, small drops all together have more surface area than that of a bigger drop. Let me give you an example of an orange. If you take an orange, appear to be a sphere, what is the surface area of it? 4 pi r square. Ab 8 pi nahi karna. Why? Because it is filled from inside. It is 4 pi r square. If you cut it from the middle, make it two pieces, what's now the surface area? 2 pi r this side, 2 pi r this side, but pi r square, how much it may be now? 6 pi r square. It increases. If you make smaller and smaller, you are increasing the surface area. Now what happens? When all these drops, they join together, their surface area decreases, their surface energy decreases, where the rest of energy will go? It will go in heating the material. So that is our concept with which we'll proceed. So what I'm writing is, here we have one relation. Look, if I have all these drops assumed to be of same size, this has been assumed, they are any number. They all merge together to give you a bigger drop. Its radius is r, and let the radius of these small drops is equals to small r. Can I have relation between the two? Volume of all these together must be same as the volume of the bigger one. So n 4 by 3 pi small r cube is equals to 4 by 3 pi capital R cube. 4 by 3 pi, 4 by 3 pi will be out. And if you take a cube root, I have n to the power 1 by 3 small r capital R. Can you tell me which is more, R or capital R? Capital R, right? Don't be confused with power 1 by 3. If you vary number more than 1 with power, maybe in fraction, you always have this quantity as more than 1, right? So it's never go less than 1. Don't worry about it. So this capital R is more, right? So once I have this relation, for the number, rest I have to do is to find out what is the difference of their surface energies, how the surface energy changes. When it's individual, each one is having an area 4 pi r square, but I have to multiply by n because they are n in number. But when they combine together, the radius becomes capital R. Now it's only single drop, 4 pi capital R square multiplied by t, that is the surface energy difference. Now the link relation is there between capital R and small r like this. So you use it and you will get this as your result. This one. This is the one result where you have to put the value of small r there to remove it. But this difference of energy will definitely go to heat the drop. And the formula for the heat energy is, Q equals to mc delta M stand for the mass, C for the specific heat, and delta T is the change in temperature. For mass, what I did, I took the volume of the bigger drop, density of the water is 1. Since everything is given in calorie, calorie is the unit of heat, and I'm relating heat to the energy work, that is the work basically. So I have to use a symbol J here. J is called the joules mechanical equivalent, and delta theta is the temperature difference. You put the value and you'll get the answer. So this is the link, how this link has been made. So these are the questions where we are mixing up the two concepts. This is very important. So I'm mixing up, say, the concept of surface tension with the heat through the energy. Through the energy we are doing it. Yes, next question. Stop it. Achha, time is up. Okay. I just left with two questions only. Anyway, that's all. Any questions? Any questions? Understood everything? Any question from other students? Site? This okay? Thank you very much. Right? Okay.